Good morning. My name is Ignacio Ramirez. I'll be your moderator for this morning session. And welcome to Archetype Pattern Workshop. This is a school, and it is not a church, and neither are we affiliated with a church or a religious organization. This school is a nonprofit, non-denominational, religious, and scientific research organization dedicated to proving the existence of Yahweh or Elohim in the operation of the eternal pattern, purpose, and plan operating throughout eternity unto this present day. Now, this school is a result of a divine vision and revelation given to Henry Clifford Kenley in the state of Ohio in the year 1931. Since that time, there have been schools established throughout the United States, Canada, and certain other foreign countries. Archetype Pattern Workshop was established on February 2021. Now, in this school, or in these schools, we use and teach by the true and original names and titles for the Heavenly Father, the Word or Son, and the Holy Spirit, which are contained in the original Hebrew text. The true name for the Heavenly Father is Yahweh. It has been improperly substituted by Lord. The true title for the Word or Son is Elohim. It also been improperly substituted by God. And the true name for the Holy Spirit manifested in or out of a physical body is Yahshua. He has been erroneously substituted by Jesus Christ. Now, Lord and God, they are titles and not names. The Apostle Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, tells us in 1 Corinthians 8 and 5 that there are Lords many and Gods many. But we now know that each Lord must have a name and each God must have a name also. Elohim is a title, but unlike Lord and God, Elohim is a divine title. This means that Elohim is the title that our Creator chose for Himself. Jesus is a name, but Jesus is an erroneous name. A minor investigation on your part into a good dictionary or encyclopedia would prove that the Hebrew language, the Greek language, nor the Latin language have any characters or letters in the alphabet that would produce the sound made by this letter J. Neither was there letter J in the English language until some 1400 years after the death of the Messiah. Therefore, such names as Jesus and Jehovah are impossible renderings for the true and original name of our Heavenly Father and His Son. Christ is a title, just like Lord and God. Now, Yahweh is pure spirit, and in this state, He's incomprehensible, inscrutable, and indiscernible. He is the ultimate source, substance, limits, and bounds of everything. We have Yahweh symbolized in His pure spirit state on this chart as a cloud. Yahweh is not a cloud. He merely chose a cloud to symbolize Himself, because a cloud has no particular or descriptive shape and form. We have drawn this cloud all around the edges of this chart to show you that everything on this chart is within the cloud. In like manner, everything in the universe abides within the pure spirit state of Yahweh. Yahweh, knowing that man could not perceive of Him in His pure spirit state, took on shape and took on form right within Himself as Elohim. This is the Word or Son, a super incorporeal being, that is, having the shape and form of a man, but without flesh and blood. And this shape and form can only be seen in a divine vision and understood in a divine revelation. Later on, this self-same spirit manifests Himself in a physical body and walked the earth plane as Yahshua the Messiah, who the world calls Jesus Christ. Now, there's only one name given us salvation, and we all must know this name. So the simple yet intelligent question we should ask ourselves is, what was the name of the Savior during the time that He walked the earth plane? A further understanding of this name and title could be had by reading the preface of the Holy Name Bible. Also, in the school, we teach by the divine pattern of the universe. It is called a divine pattern because it is Yahweh's pattern. Thereafter Yahweh led the children of Israel out of the land of Egypt. He called Moses on top of Mount Sinai and showed him a tabernacle pattern in a vision. And he instructed Moses to build one exactly like it in the wilderness of Sinai. This pattern consists of a most holy place, a holy place, and a court round about. These three compartments make up the one tabernacle pattern. And we go forth in the school to prove that everything in the universe moves and operates according to the structure and function of the threefold tabernacle pattern, and absolutely nothing escapes the pattern. Now the 10 aims of the school are as follows. One is to help you find and know Yahweh or Elohim as he really is and as he actually exists. Two is to form a nucleus of universal brotherhood of humanity in Yahshua the Messiah, without the sticks of race, nationality, creed, sex, caste, or color. Third is to investigate the unexplained spirit law, or so-called law of nature, and the powers latent in man. Fourth is to encourage and promote the study of the scriptures, comparative religions, psychology, philosophy, modern, practical, and occult science. Fifth is to extirpate current superstitions, skepticism, and ignorance. Sixth is to learn, know, and understand the operation of Yahweh's eternal purpose through the dispensation and ages. Seventh is to discern and avoid being deceived by Lucifer, the serpent, the dragon, the devil, or Satan, and his demons operating the mystery of iniquity on earth through the dispensation of time. And eighth is to earnestly contend for the common salvation of faith that was once delivered unto the sons or children of Yahweh. And ninth is to make known that Yahweh, from the beginning ordained, there is no other name given among men whereby man must be saved, saving the name of Yahshua the Messiah. And tenth is to inherit eternal life now in the kingdom of Yahshua the Messiah with the hope of immortal glorification in the new earth state. Our watchword is peace, and our slogan, speak the truth. This morning I have a prayer by Dr. Eunice Reiser. Our scripture lesson is Isaiah, the 57th chapter, and our scripture reader will be Dr. Irene Ramirez. A scripture reader will be Dr. Eunice Reiser. Dr. Irene Ramirez. You're going to do the prayer, right? In the prayer by Dr. Irene Ramirez. Oh, man. And we have a selection of music after the prayer. It's messed up, getting old.
Good day, class. We'd like to ask Yahweh Elohim, and we'd like to thank him first for giving us a place to come to so we could learn about him and we could see how he has set up everything for us, so we could see how he really is and actually exists, especially through his son, Yahshua the Messiah. But we do like to ask you to keep us here and learning. And we ask this every day, and we'd like to thank you for that. And thank you through your son, Yahshua Messiah. Let's all say hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Caught up in a world they say happened by chance. They want to believe that it's all in their hands. They try to convince me they shape their own destinies. But if they knew Yah like I know Yah, they'd get down on their knees. Yes, if they knew Yah like I know Yah, they'd get down on their knees. They don't know he's in complete control. Elohim is running his show, yeah. He's in complete control. choice is the law they're spreading around. Divine intervention is nice if God is ever around. They don't wanna believe their every step was patterned by him, that he's got it wrapped up tight, line upon line. They're going back to spirit again. He's got it wrapped up tight, line upon line. They're going back to spirit again. They don't know he's in complete control. Elohim is running his show. He's in complete control. Elohim is running his show. Jeremiah, I made you a prophet long before this earth had shape without form, before it was void. Yeah. He said, I possessed your ways before I made the deep blue sea. I am the cause, the reason for it all, and all I had to do was speak. Yes, I am the cause, the reason for it all, and all I had to do was speak. They don't know he's in complete control. Elohim is running his show, yeah. He's in complete control. Elohim is running his show. He's Alpha Omega, Almighty Creator.
Good morning, class. Our scripture lesson will be taken from Isaiah, the 57th chapter, page 862, and I'll be reading out of the Holy Name Version, the Holy Name Bible. Got it. It just left my mind, sorry. I'll be reading out of the Holy Name Bible containing the Holy Name Version of the Old and New Testament. Critically compared with ancient authorities and various manuscripts revised by the late A.B. Trainum. Isaiah, the 57th chapter. The righteous perish, and no man layeth it to heart, and merciful men are taken away, none considering that the righteous is taken away from the evil to come. He shall enter into peace. They shall repose in their resting place, every one that walketh in his uprighteousness. But draw near hither, ye sons of the sorceress, the seed of the adulterers, and the whore. Against whom do ye sport yourself? Against whom make ye a wide mouth and draw out the tongue? Are ye not children of transgression, a seed of falsehood? Inflaming yourselves with idols under every green tree, slaying the children in the valleys under the clefts of the rocks, among the smooth stones of the stream is thy portion. They are thy lot. Even to them hast thou poured a drink offering. Thou hast offered a meal offering. Should I receive comfort in these? Upon a lofty and high mountain hast thou set thy bed. Even thither wentest thou up to offer sacrifice. Behind the doors also and the posts hast thou set up the memorials. For thou hast discovered thyself to another than me, and art gone up. Thou hast enlarged thy bed, and make thee a covenant with them. Thou lovest thy bed where thou sawest, and thou wentest to Moloch with ointment, and didst increase thy perfume, and didst send thy messengers far off, and didst debase thyself even unto the grave. Thou, though art weary by the length of thy way, yet sayest thou, not it is useless. Thou hast found enough satisfaction, therefore didst thou feel no care. And of whom hast thou been afraid or feared, that thou hast been false, and hast not remembered me, nor laid it to thy heart? Have not I held my peace even of old, and thou fearest me not? I will expose thy righteousness and thy works, for they shall not profit thee. When thou criest, let thy companies deliver thee, but the wind shall carry them all away. Vanity shall take them, but he that putteth his trust in me shall possess the land, and shall inherit my holy mountain. And shall say, cast ye up, prepare the way, take up the stumbling block out of the way of my people. For thus saith the high and lofty one, that inhabited eternity, whose name is holy. I dwell in the high and holy place with him also that is of a contrite and humble spirit, to revive the spirit of the humble and to revive the heart of the contrite ones. For I will not contend forever, neither will I be always wroth, for the spirit before me would faint for the souls which I have made. For the iniquity of his covetousness was I wroth, and smote him. I hid me, and was wroth, and he went on forward in the ways of his heart. I have seen his ways, and will heal him. I will lead him also, and restore comforts unto him and his mourners. I create the fruit of the lips, peace, peace to him that is afar off, and to him that is near, saith Yahweh, and I will heal him. But the wicked are like the troubled sea, when it cannot rest, whose waters cast up mire and dirt. There is no peace, said my Elohim, to the wicked. I have read Isaiah, the 57th chapter. Let us all say, hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Eunice Reiser. Good evening. Good morning once again. It's good to be here, okay, out of that outside and that chaos. All right, as we start, we're going to set up a foundation for the next speaker. As we've been saying, we're going to struggle to do this for everybody and for the new people so they can understand what we're teaching down here, okay? This is the tabernacle, called the tabernacle pattern, okay? It's got nine vessels, or principal vessels, in this tabernacle, okay? And there's lectures on these principles. Now, we have the migration trick, which you call, and Dr. Kenley would call this the greater, more perfect tabernacle or sanctuary, okay? And we correlate the events or these principles from the tabernacle over to the wilderness or over to this migratory trek here, okay? So there's seven steps in this tabernacle, that the high priest does, or the low priest, to officiate here. Okay, and the children of Israel are going through these things in the leadership of Moses and Joshua, son of Nun. So the first step is a gate here in the outer court or court around about. Okay, second step is this brazen altar of sin sacrifice with the four horns in its corners. Okay, third step is this brazen laver of water where the high priest washed himself and also washed the sacrifice. Okay, four is the door. Okay, we always say that. Four is the door. And at the door, there's a cup of holy anointing oil, which the high priest is anointed once to officiate in this tabernacle here, and the low priest also at the same time. Now, going through the door, we enter the fifth step, which is the holy place. Here you got three golden vessels or items here. The seven-branch lampstand, the golden seven-branch lampstand, the golden table of showbread, which the golden crown around it, which had 12 loaves of bread. Okay. We have the altar of incense, golden altar of incense, that the high priest put four ingredients to burn, and it would produce a sweet-smelling savior unto Yahweh. He's sitting on the throne. The first ingredient would be onycha. What was it? Stacton, galvania, and frankincense. I don't know, there's only four, and they're hard to remember for me. Okay. Now, the next step is the second veil. Okay. That is the sixth step. Okay. The high priest would go through, he'd take some coals off the altar, put in a censer, and he would swing it like if he's going up on a cloud. And he enters into the most holy place, which is seven steps. Here you have this threefold configuration, okay, of the throne of Yahweh, which you had two archangels facing each other, but they weren't looking at each other. They're just witnessing in the cloud, okay, upon the mercy seat. Now, below in the chest, we have the second tables of stone, which Yahweh wrote on. Moses took up his set of stones up there. Aaron's rod that budded in a jar of manna that Yahweh rained down in the wilderness of Sinai. Okay. Now, we have the four principle. There's also a 40 principle, 40 weeks to build this tabernacle. Okay, now we'll go over to the migration trick. The first step is like the gate, was the entrance to the children of Israel's houses, where they had to take the sacrifice and kill it and take the blood and put it on the lintels, the two side posts. Well, that second step is this. See the altar here where they put the sacrifice? Well, they had to put the sacrifice there and they had to roast it, okay? Now, the third step is they have to be ready, because Yahweh said they're going to be leaving that night because of the Passover. The angel was going to pass over and slay the firstborn of man and beast, whoever doesn't put the blood on their door. Okay? Now, you know he didn't tell the Egyptians anything, so guess what? You know, their animals and their firstborn, they died when that angel came over and he didn't see the blood on the door. And whoever disobeyed and did put the blood on the door, their firstborn would be dead. Okay, would die. Now they took a trick up to the Red Sea. Okay, that'd be like the third step. Okay, like the laver here, Red Sea. Well, when the high priest washed his sacrifice, the blood would go in the water and it would stain it red, as we have the Red Sea here, the correlation. And they followed like the door into the holy place. There the Red Sea parted, and there Moses and the children of Israel and Joshua went through. Now, they just didn't go out there blind. They followed this cloud, a pillar of cloud by day and a pillar of fire by night. okay? Phenomenal sight, which led them through and through the Red Sea into the fifth step here, which is the holy place, or the holy place of the migration trek. Here you have, took 40 weeks to build this tabernacle, which Yahweh gave them divine specifications to build, okay? Now we have light, just like here in a holy place. We have bread and intercession. So the light, we just mentioned that this cloud went up and sat upon Mount Sinai, and there it turned into a cloud by day and a pillar of fire by night, okay, to keep the children of Israel light all the time. They call them Israelites. Okay, the next step is bread, okay? Now, children of Israel constantly murmuring for things. They would, you know, say, oh, we shouldn't have came out of Egypt. We had the flesh pots there, we could be eating. But Moses went to Joshua, okay, and told him what the people wanted. And Joshua told Moses what to do, okay? 6 days it would rain down manna, and they would pick it up. And on the sixth day, they're supposed to pick up twice as much amount, because on the Sabbath, Yahweh wasn't going to rain down anything, okay? Well, you know, there's some that disobeyed anyway. They pay for it. So you had light, the cloud, bread, the manna. Now you have intercession, okay? Now, in the bigger chart over there, you see there's a little tent off to the side, okay, which was the tent of the congregation where Moses would meet Joshua face to face. If he had any questions that the children of Israel wanted, he'd go in there and talk to Joshua. Okay, that's intercession. All right. So we have light, bread, intercession. Now the children of Israel had to follow this cloud. Okay, whenever the cloud raised up above the tabernacle, they knew it was time to pack up and leave, because this cloud wasn't stopping for any of them. Okay, now it led them to the Jordan River, which would be the sixth step, okay? The Jordan River parted, and the high priest or the priest put their foot right on the brim of the river. It opened up and led the children of Israel through into the promised land, okay? Now, that's the seventh step, okay? Canaan's land, okay? There on top of Mount Moriah, they built Solomon's temple, okay? It was decked out with precious stones, gold. You can read about it. It had a porch, a sanctuary, and an oracle. Threefold configuration, just like this tabernacle here, okay? And this was the throne of Yahweh, okay? Because it says it looked like a man sitting on his throne, okay? Now, there's a verse, I think, in Isaiah where it says, heaven is my throne, and the earth is my footstool. So you have all these things correlating to this tabernacle pattern. And it doesn't stop there, okay? Because you got a whole Bible filled with things, okay? That before you come into this teaching, you didn't know anything about. Now it makes sense, okay? Because if you don't apply this tabernacle pattern to the things that you read, and they're all about Yahshua the Messiah, you're lost. Okay, so that's just a basic foundation that we're going to follow. So anybody that's new, you know, still studying, trying to figure this thing out, this is what we go by. Okay, and there's other things, other correlations, okay, but this is the basic one that you could springboard off of. Okay, and I'm going to call the next speaker, which is Dr. Will Williams. He's the CEO and director of Archetype Pattern Workshop. Okay.
Good morning, class. Good morning. It is indeed an honor and a pleasure to be here with you to learn more of this great and awesome, colossal, stupendous panoramic vision and revelation given to us by Yahweh our Elohim, who is the resurrected Yahshua the Messiah. And I appreciate the moderator setting up the premise for what this class is about. And actually, because he announced in the moderation that this class was set up, I'm talking about the corporation, our type pattern workshop was set up in February of 2021. Actually, this Wednesday will be the 3-year anniversary of the corporation, all right? And all I can say is I thank Yahweh for preserving us this far, okay? You know, because I tell you, when I first started, I didn't know from Shinola, okay? Seriously, all right? But I trusted in the spirit of Yahweh. And my little rule is simply this. If a situation is occurring, but I feel like it's the hand of Yahweh involved and I may be not understanding it fully, I say, well, if Yahweh is the one that's doing this, then I'll just step back and defer to the greater wisdom and just let it play itself out. Okay? And then I did, and Yahweh played it the way he wanted it, and it was the right way, because his way is going to be a good way, you know? So I appreciate Yahweh for preserving us, you know, this far. And I appreciate the other folks who, at the time when I was considering filing for corporation, they rendered their assistance and their advice, things like that. So I appreciate, you know, quite a few people who did that. And in the beginning, we had to find a place. We was out in the valley at Joseph Iris' mother's house for a few sessions. And then we lost that. Then we had to meet over at Kinaway's place in Santa Monica for a couple of sessions. And then we had to try to find some other places. We didn't have any more private places to go. No, we ran out of private homes, so we had to go public. And that was one of the main reasons why I decided to file for corporations, because in the early days, like we got this one place, at some African American museum in Pomona and stuff like that, and I had to pay for the rent, and people wanted to donate money. There were people who, you know, and they were sending me money, and though I didn't ask for it, but I felt like, well, gosh, you know, I don't want to take this money in my name, because then it could easily end up in my pocket. So that's when I decided. I said, well, I need to file for a corporation. And it just so happened that I had just came back from going cross country, and I was getting my mail that had backed up for a couple of weeks, and there was a letter, an advertising letter for a bunch of law clerks, you know, to say that we could do whatever you want, you know, file. So I was like, you know, I said, I wonder, you know. So they were in Encino, in the valley, just on the other side of the hills from where I live. So I gave them a call and talked to them, and they were real nice. And they just, they really helped me out. I had to pay for it, mind you, but they really were great as far as getting the paperwork together, because I didn't know anything, you know, and they did that. And they sent me correspondence through emails, and, you know, and the one thing they asked me was, what is this corporation based on? You know, they wanted to just give me a few words. What is this corporation that you're building? What is the principles? What are the tenets of it? And you know what I did? This is what I did. And I wrote it down and sent it back to them, because they sent it to me on an email on a form. And this is what, that's the wrong one. And this is what I wrote to them, what the tenets were. And basically, what I told them, what I wrote to them was the first three aims, you know, of class. And this is what I told them. I said, this is what this organization is based on. One, to help you find and know Yahweh, our Elohim, as he really is and actually exists. Two, to form a nucleus of universal brotherhood of humanity in Yahshua the Messiah without distinction of race or nationality, creed, sex, caste, or color. And three, to investigate the unexplained spirit law, or so-called law of nature, and the powers latent in man. And that's what I sent in to them. And they looked at it and they said, okay. So, and they went on and proceeded to do the paperwork for me. These folks were so good, they even wrote out a constitution for me. You know, bylaws and stuff like that. They went through the trouble of doing that for me. So that was really, really nice of them, you know. So, and they do our taxes. You know, that's one thing I had to learn about being a director of a nonprofit, a 501c3 nonprofit organization. You got to file for taxes. And that was a new thing I had to learn. And the corporation as it stands is basically a board of directors, which I am one, but the other two directors are Irene Ramirez and Kinaway Kleinschmidt. That's the board of directors. They're like the overseers over the organization. And we have a set of officers. It's required by law that you have to have three directors and you have to have at least three officers, a president, secretary, and a treasurer. When I filed myself as the president, Irene Ramirez being the secretary, and Kinaway Kleinschmidt being the treasurer. Okay. Now, since we have re-merged with the former Ontario class, you know, the directors have not changed, but the officers have. Okay. Irene, who was secretary, has been replaced by Nanette Ramirez, her daughter. And Kinaway Kleinschmidt, who was the treasurer, has been replaced by Eunice Reiser. Okay. No one has replaced me yet, though I wouldn't mind. In fact, I wouldn't mind stepping down maybe around the end of the year, and I'll just remain as director. In fact, I'll throw this out here as an offer. If anybody out there wants to relocate to California and come here and join this class, and you come here and hang around for 4 or 5 months and show us that you're really into the gospel and you're trying to build this organization, I will step down and give the office to you. Now, can't do any better than that. Okay, because I recognize that there's, you know, I mean, we have to grow in the sense of getting other people involved, you know, so that in the case of my, well, when Joe Williams died, what did we do? Did we stop and say, oh, well, we got to close down and close shop? And you know, did we do that? No. No, we didn't. Because that's not what he would have wanted. You know, I mean, I remember Joe Williams back in the day. And listen, we have a unique situation here. This is an anniversary here, you know, for the organization, Archetype Pattern Workshop. But when May comes around, that'll be the anniversary for the old Ontario class that Joe Williams started in his house just up the road from here. Okay? No, I'm sorry.
Ain't gone nowhere.
I'm saying, you know, I mean, when Joe Williams started, the hotel up here, the Ramada Inn, that's where he started at, because it was just close to his house. And that hotel went through so many changes of names. It was Ramada Inn, Ramada Limited, what else? It was like 4 or 5 of them. And they had different managers in there until they got these Hindus in there, and they were the ones that kicked us out. You know, but I remember the other guy, the Asian guy manager. I used to call him Mr. Jim. He was good because he would put out donuts and fresh coffee and whatnot. I said, Mr. Jim, that's all right. You're doing all right, sir. You're a good guy to me. But that's what we've had to do. And I'm talking about Ontario class. And then we had to go to, what was that, the ice cream shop. We was over there for a while. And then we had the downtown, the theater, the old theater downtown Ontario. We was there on the 3rd floor. You know, we had that for a while. And the elevator wouldn't work half the time, so a lot of people wouldn't come because of that. Yeah, so we've gone through a lot. Okay, and you know, and I was part of that, you know, for Ontario. I was in Ontario class for 25 years, okay? So, and the memories and the experiences, you know, of all the folks that came through, they still exist here. You know, Joe Williams, Reggie Thomas, you know, Rip Macklin, Peter Godot, because he was a member of this class toward the end of his days, you know? So all these people, they're still part of us in that sense, you know? So, it's not so much, I mean, the organization, IDMR of, you know, Ontario class of IDMR is gone as an entity. And in its place stands Archetype Pattern Workshop. However, The gospel of Yahshua Messiah is still the same. The doctrine that Dr. Kinley espoused unto us, that he received, is still the same. The charts that we have displayed up here, they're still the same. All right? You know, the name may have changed, you know, but the game is still the same. You understand? And that's all that we're trying to do. And archetype, and the reason why I even chose Archetype Pattern Workshop as a name was because Tuesday nights was the night usually that I would run the workshop. And I got that, if you knew the story behind that, you know, well, I won't tell it. But anyway, I was allowed that. You know, to give me, you know, because I asked for it, because I wanted to get into things that a lot of people didn't get into. When I first came to Ontario class, nobody had a textbook out, nobody had pamphlets out, no one ever even heard of transcripts. But because I was in Lee Warren's class and other classes, I knew, so I just said, well, look, I'll just create access to this information so that you can look at it and make a determination on your own. See, and that's all I've ever tried to do, is to create access to information about this doctrine. And there's a lot of things about this doctrine that people have not yet heard of, because for whatever reason, well, I'll tell you, I can get really into this, because this is 30 years after they had that infamous Deans and Presidents meeting in L.A., where they got their marching orders on this new progressive doctrine. And see, and the effect of that is that it forced people to go into very basic, just stay basic. And, you know, and it was like a comfort zone type thing. And anytime someone tried to go beyond, like what the first speaker did, like these steps, you know, because people were just so used to hearing, well, blood, water, spirit, 40. Anything beyond that, well, you don't need to know that. See, and then people that would go through that, they were accused of, well, you're going ahead of the cloud, that kind of thing, you know, or you're skywriting, you're trying to show how smart you are, that type of thing. And see, Dr. Kinley said this about the term going ahead of the cloud, because people would say that, and they said that to me. But what he meant by it was, he said, by getting up here, he said, you're going ahead of the cloud if you're getting up here talking about something you don't understand yet. That's moving ahead of the cloud. See, but if you can get up here and explain it, see, according to the steps, according to the purpose, then you're not moving ahead of the cloud. You're right with the cloud. See, going through these steps. Okay? Now, I want to... We're supposed to be doing our winter series of lectures, and I know it's been kind of disjointed, but I'm okay with that, because, see, the subject is open, and these charts are here as tools for you to ascertain the purpose and plan of Yahweh, okay? Now, the first speaker got up here, and he went through the seven steps of this tabernacle pattern as corresponding to the seven steps of the migratory pattern. And it's the correlations between these two that you're going to use to understand all these different plates, because it's going according to this pattern, okay? Unless somebody has a particular subject, I'm going to go over here and pick this little jar up. And it's a moderation of what the old jar we used to have of picking these numbers of this little game that Yahweh showed me for this 11-year-old girl. Why don't you come up here, my man? Yes, you. Yes, you. Come on up here. I want you to do us all a favor here. I want you to reach it. Oops. Let me get them all in here. Oh, would you get that for me down there? Pick that up. Yeah, see, I want to get all these. Yeah, get them all in here. All right. Throw that in there. Now, what I want you to do, reach in there and pull out a number. Just reach in there. Just grab us out a number. All right. And this is what he pulled. He pulled number 32. That's Pentecost. Thank you very much. Go have a seat. Oops. We got to get a new jar. That's all there's to it. I can't find my old one. I packed it away. It's in storage somewhere. Okay. Now, in fact, why don't you pick up number 31? All right, thank you. Okay, now, and the reason why I did it, I'm having it like this, because here, this is Yahshua's death, burial, resurrection, and this is an ascension. Whereas this plate, when it comes over, and it will come over here to this plate, and this is a descending plate. Okay? Now, the first speaker mentioned it. He mentioned about Moses' three trips into the mount. Okay, Moses made three trips into the mount. First trip, he was told to, he was given instructions to give to the Israelites to wash up, clean themselves up, don't go against the wash for 3 days, don't touch this mountain. And after 3 days, they would assemble and Yahweh would speak to them. He would thunder down to them the Ten Commandment law. The second trip, he went up, and that's illustrated here with Moses laying down, and he sees this panoramic vision of Elohim, and along with Aaron, Nadab, and Abihu, and seven of the elders, and they see this shape and form, standing on the paved work of a sapphire stone. In it, Moses sees the days of creation, and he sees the instructions and the specifications for this tabernacle pattern. All right, then he comes down. First tables of stone that he received, he throws it, breaks it because of the Israelites worshiping the golden calf. So he has to go back up, and he goes back up with his own set of stones. Matter of fact, let's read that. Exodus 34 and 1. And the reason why I'm doing this, because this plate here, plate 31, Yahshua here, see, his death, burial, resurrection, and ascension from the Mount of Olives is a fulfillment of Moses' third trip into the mount. Okay? That's the point I wanted to get to. Do we have that?
Exodus 34 and 1.
Mm-hmm.
And Yahweh said unto Moses, Hew thee two tables of stone, mm-hmm. like unto the first.
Mm-hmm.
And I will write upon these tables the words that was in the first table, which thou breakest. And be ready in the morning, and come up in the morning unto Mount Sinai, and present thyself to me in the top of the mount. And no man shall come up with thee, neither let any man be seen throughout all the mount, neither let the flock nor herd feed before the mount. And he hewed two tables of stone like unto the first. And Moses rose up early in the morning, and went up into the Mount Sinai, as Yahweh had commanded him, and took in his hand the two tables of stone.
All right, good enough. Now, this is the beginning of Moses' third trip into the mount. All right. Now, as we said, on his second trip, the first time he sees the vision. All right. He sees the vision, and he sees the man being created on the sixth day. He sees the woman being created, taking, you know, the womb and the rib taken out of the man, and a womb man brought to the man. And they're up here in peace and harmony. All right. And then on the seventh day, Elohim rested. Now Yahweh takes his attention away from Adam and Eve, and he shows him this tabernacle pattern. Okay? And he's instructed to build the same thing in the wilderness with the exact specifications that he's shown up here in the mount. Are we? Oh, okay. That's something different, or we're not? Okay. Okay. Just wondering. All right. Yeah. So now, Moses is up here a total of 40 days, 7 days for the vision, 33 days for the specifications of this tabernacle. All right. Then he comes back down the mount. All right, and then he's got the tables of stone in his hand. See, the tables of stone was cut out of this mountain here and was written with the finger of Elohim and was presented to Moses. So now when Moses comes back down and he's with Joshua, Joshua says, well, I hear a noise of war, and they come up and they see these people partying around this golden calf. All right, so Moses breaks the first tables of stone. All right, and so now he deals with these folks. And then now he has to hew out another set, and he has to go up And that's what we read in the 34th chapter. That's the beginning of the third trip up the mount. And so when he goes up here, all right, he's going to see a rerun of this vision. And when I say that, I like to do this. Because if you really want to know what the rerun was, just look at the illustration of the 40-plate chart. Because that's what he's rerun. See, he's seeing a rerun. Okay, I think I'm there with you. The mic. Just turn the mic off, Eunice. Your mic. Turn it off. It's off? Okay. Oh, you're right. I forgot about that. Yeah, I was getting ready to go through this Jimi Hendrix phase. So now he's seeing a rerun of this. All right, the days of creation, Elohim appearing, and the days of creation. All right, and he's seeing a rerun of this. And he sees Adam being born, and seeing that's reflected in the second chapter of Genesis. Where he goes, because you have to remember this. Joshua was the one, I'll go back up here. No, Joshua was the one that, Joshua went up with him, all right, and transfigured before him and showed him the vision the first time and the specifications for the tabernacle. So when Moses went back down, yeah, he broke the tables of stone. He dealt with the people worshiping the golden calves. But at the same time, he had to talk to the 70 elders because he had been gone 40 days. As far as they was concerned, oy boy, well, because look, this was a fiery inferno. It was a fiery inferno. It was an earthquake. It was lightnings. It was thundering. There was darkness. I mean, this was a fearful sight to these people. And they see Moses going up into this inferno, and he's gone for 40 days. As far as these 70 elders were concerned, as far as they were concerned, oy boy, that's it for Moses. Until Moses came back. And then when Moses, I need to bring this in. Exodus 24 and 16. See, and now when Moses came back and the elders asked him, well, Moses, what happened to you? See, read 16.
Exodus 24:16, and the glory of Yahweh abode upon Mount Sinai, and the cloud covered it 6 days, colon. And the seventh day he called unto Moses out of the midst of the cloud.
All right. Now she said, she read, and the cloud covered it 6 days, colon. That's the obligatory colon. We say that because an explanation is needed. So that explanation, you have to go back to Genesis 1 and 1. Because when Moses went to the 70 elders, they asked him, Moses, what happened? And he just simply recited, as it states in Genesis 1 and 1, well, in the beginning, Elohim created the heavens and the earth. And the earth was without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep. That's what he's explaining to them. Okay? Now, that's after the second trip. Now, mind you, Joshua, the son of Nun, is with him, and he's coming back down the mount with Moses, and he hears Moses explaining this. And Joshua's saying, oh, Moses, you left a couple of things out. But that's okay, because I'm going to bring you back up here, and I'm going to show you a recapitulation of it and remind you what you left out. See? And that's why, when you talk about the third trip, what did Moses see? It's always best to go to the 40-plate chart because the 40-plate chart is what Moses saw. And he saw the rerun of the creation. And this time, he goes into a further explanation of how the woman was made. See, he goes into explanation of how the earth was watered and things. See, and also, he sees this. See, he sees Satan here arriving or coming into the entrance of the garden, spying out their nakedness, okay? And then goes on into the transgression. Now, the reason why, see, a lot of people don't understand, this is plate 13 and it has the migratory pattern. Why is the migratory pattern here at this junction after this plate? Because Moses is up the mountain. That's why. And he's receiving the vision up there. See? And the reason why this plate is here, plate 14, this is to let you know what was the cause of the transgression.
Right. Okay.
That's why. See, if people would sit down and try to understand, look, there are seven plates, seven charts that Dr. Kinley drew, and they're for a reason. They serve a purpose. And you have to sit down and allow the charts, the vision, however you want to say it, to explain itself to you. See? And this didn't hit me until we made this big chart. I just had to be on the floor one day, and Yahweh showed me and said, oh, this is what Moses saw on the third trip, because he saw the transgression, and he saw 63 subsequent generations of the flesh coming all the way down. See, down to Pentecost. I got the Pentecost plate up there, but he saw all of this. He saw Nebuchadnezzar and the Persians and Alexander the Great. And he saw all of that. Yahweh showed him all of that. But he was told, and see, here's the migratory pattern. Why is the migratory pattern in this position? Because it's Moses is writing this vision. And see, and this is where he's going to end off here. Because, see, the whole five books of the Bible is based on what Moses wrote in the divine vision. Moses wrote about his birth, and he also wrote about his death. See, and he wrote it here. And this is where they stop at. Moses is buried here. See, they mourned his death 30 days, then prepared 3 days for victuals, 33 days, pointing to Yahshua Messiah being 33 years in the flesh. Okay? All these things have a reason if you take the time to walk through this. The pattern will explain itself to you if you allow it. See? Now, we're back here and we're at Moses'. Now, that's Moses' third trip into the mount. All right? And so when he comes back down, I think it's in the scripture. Go to 34, Exodus 34 and 27. Let's read that.
Exodus 34, 27.
Mm-hmm.
And Yahweh said unto Moses, write thou these words, for after the tenor of these words, I have made a covenant with thee and with Israel.
Mm-hmm.
And he was there with Yahweh 40 days and 40 nights.
Now, he was there 40 days and 40 nights. This is the third trip that he's up there. So he sees the rerun of the vision, and he sees 63 generations of the flesh, as we outlined on the 40-plate chart. Okay? Now, keep reading.
He did neither eat bread nor drink water.
In other words, he didn't bring a sack lunch with him up there. Okay? See? Go ahead.
And he wrote upon the tables the words of the covenant, the Ten Commandments.
Oh, now, and Yahweh Elohim wrote on the tables of stone that Moses brought up. And look, this was a heart-shaped set of stone. So, in effect, Moses is bringing his own heart up. And Elohim is writing the words on his heart. Get it?
Yeah.
All right. Go ahead.
And it came to pass when Moses came down from Mount Sinai with the two tables of testimony in Moses' hand, when he came down from the mount, that Moses knew not that the skin of his face shone.
Now, see, now his, in other words, Moses began to radiate light. All right. Let's just take the natural. We have light bulbs in here, you know, that do light. And if you know anything about basic electricity, it takes a positive wire and a negative wire, all right, to produce light. Well, let's look here. Moses, on the second trip up, and the first time he saw the vision, he saw Adam and Eve up here being created, but Yahweh paused it and then showed him the tabernacle pattern. In other words, he saw Adam and Eve up here in peace and in harmony. Or in other words, he saw the good. Then he was brought up again the third time and saw the recapitulation. And this time he sees the transgression, the negative. All right. So now he sees the positive, and now he sees the negative. His consciousness is illuminated because now he sees both mysteries at work: the mystery of righteousness and the mystery of iniquity. He's illuminated. He's coming down now from the mount. See, and this is the point I want to get to. Here's Yahshua the Messiah. This is his death, his burial, his resurrection. All right, here's his death. All right, which is a fulfillment of the lamb in Egypt. Let's just draw a line. It's a fulfillment of that lamb down here in Egypt. All right? Taken out on the 10th, held over to the 14th, killed between the two evenings. All right? Which accounts for 3.5 days. Why? Because, draw a line, because Joshua was 3.5 years in his ministry.
Right.
All right? Come back. The blood was put on the lintel of the door, 2 side posts, the basin and the beneath. And the lamb was killed kosher style. See, it was pierced in the side and no bones were broken. Mm-hmm. Draw a line. That's what happened to Joshua. Crown of thorns in his head, nails in his hands, nails in his feet, 4 points of blood. Here's the soldier here, piercing him in the side. Because he broke the other guy's legs. That was a way to hasten up death and say, hey, you know, we want to get off this shift early, so let's, you know, break the legs and that'll hasten it. But when they came to Joshua, he was already dead. So the soldier punched him in the side, and out with came blood and water. But that's a fulfillment of the lamb in Egypt, because that's how it was killed, kosher style. Okay? Now we're going up here to, here's Joshua's his burial. Now he's buried in Joseph's new tomb up here. All right, and that's a burial. And see, look, these also mirror the feast days. Joshua was killed on the feast of the Passover. He's in the tomb. Oh, let's get that. John. Oh, John. Is it John 12:31? I think that's what I want. 12 and 30. That's what I want. No, it's not 12. Definitely not that. 19. 19 and 30. Start there.
John 19 and 30.
Uh-huh.
When Joshua therefore had received the vinegar, he said, it is finished.
Uh-huh.
And he bowed his head and expired.
Read.
The Jews therefore, because it was the preparation that the body should not remain upon the cross on the Sabbath day.
You see, it shouldn't remain on the cross on the Sabbath day. Now, that was one thing, but here's something else. Read.
For that Sabbath day was a high day.
Now, that Sabbath day was also a high day. What do you mean? It was the Feast of Unleavened Bread. If he's dying, because see, the Passover was Abib or April the 14th. The Feast of Unleavened Bread was Abib or April the 15th. All right? So they had to get him off that cross before sundown because that was the beginning of the Sabbath. But that Sabbath also was a high day. It was the Feast of Unleavened Bread, which means unleavened bread means has no yeast to it. So there's no rise to it. So he's in here.
Right.
For the Sabbath day. I'm talking about Joshua. He's in there for the Sabbath and, you know, and he's not rising because the Feast of Unleavened Bread says there's no yeast, there's no risen either. And look, he's fulfilling the Sabbath because he's not batting an eye or twitching a muscle. See? And now somebody says, oh, I could do that. Well, can you resurrect the next day? Yeah, you can die and be in the be in the coffin, you know, for a whole day. You ain't moving. But the next day, can you get up out of that coffin? I think not. Okay? All right? So now, is there anything? Yeah, keep reading that.
For that Sabbath day was a high day.
Mm-hmm.
Besought Pilate that their legs might be broken and that they might be taken away.
In other words, they said, look, we want to get hurried and get out of here, you know, because see, the way crucifixion was a death by asphyxiation. See, and as long as you got your leg, you know, you up your legs to hold you up, you know, you can still. But once your legs is broken and you can't push yourself up, and you're like, you'll die from asphyxiation, and it was a painful, very painful death. Okay. All right. Now, here, let's get, since we're over here. All right, his death and his burial. All right. Now here's the resurrection. Let's get Mark 16 and 1.
Mark 16 and 1. And when the Sabbath was passed, Miriam Magdalene and Miriam, the mother of James and Salome, had brought sweet spices that they might come and anoint him. And very early in the morning, the first day of the week, they came unto the sepulchre, at the rising of the sun.
All right, pause right there. Now, there's two things that they mention here that we can look at. If we just draw a line and go to the pattern, see? And said what? She brought spices. Why? Because the first speaker talked about the incense here that was for the altar of incense. See, that'd be like the spices. And saying they came at first light. See, that would be like the lampstand. See, that'd be like the lampstand. Keep reading.
And they said among themselves, who shall roll us away the stone from the door of the sepulcher?
Now, who shall roll the stone away? But keep going.
For it was very great.
It was a big old stone, you know, I mean.
And when they looked, they saw that the stone was rolled away.
Now, the stone was rolled away. Why? Let's just draw a line. See, we can come over here to the migratory pattern. See, the Red Sea opened up. See, or rolled back and dry land appeared. The door here is open. See? All right? It was open. See, so that the sunlight could come in here. Because see here at the lampstand. See, this lampstand. See, look, when they were back here. When they were in the wilderness of Sinai, it was a cloud by day and a pillar of fire by night. All right? The pillar of fire that came by night came at 3:00 in the afternoon. How do I know? Because that's when this was lit. 3:00 in the afternoon, so that it would light up, all right? Now, this tabernacle was always facing east, even after it being deconstructed and carried about. When they constructed it, it had to face east toward the rising sun. So when the sun rise, it would shine through the door, and by 9:00 in the morning, they would put the lampstand out. But at that point, the sunlight is shining through into the holy place. Okay, all right. So now we got that. Let's get the bread thing in here right quick. Let's get Luke 24:44. I'm thinking 24:25. That's what I want. Start there, because now this is after his resurrection, and he's on the road to Emmaus. And he runs into these guys, and this is what happens. And they're like, oh, you know, where you been? Don't you know what happened this past weekend, man? Oh, man, a great prophet got killed. And it was an earthquake, and the sun went down twice in a day. I mean, it was like, where were you at when this was going on? You know? But read.
Luke 24:25. Then he said unto them, O fools and slow of heart, to believe all that the prophets have spoken. Ought not the Messiah to have suffered these things and to enter into his glory?
Mm-hmm.
And beginning at Moses and all the prophets, he expounded unto them in all the scriptures the things concerning himself. And they drew nigh unto the village whither they went, and he made as though he would have gone further. But they constrained him, saying, Abide with us, for it is towards evening, and the day is far spent. And he went in to tarry with them. And it came to pass, as he sat at the table with them, he took bread and blessed it and brake and gave to them.
Now, that's the principle. This is after his resurrection. This is in the holy place. That's bread. That's the bread principle. Why? I could draw a line. See, in the wilderness of Sinai, they received manna from heaven. Over here in the tabernacle, here's the table of shewbread, which was the daily sustenance for the priest. Okay? And see, and get Acts 1 and 2 right quick, and we'll round this out. Because we got the light, the bread, and the intercessor, but now we want to get the 40 principle involved here.
Acts 1 and 2.
Mm-hmm.
Until the day in which he was taken up. After that, he, through the Holy Spirit, had given commandments unto the apostles whom he had chosen, to whom also he showed himself alive after his passion, by many infallible proofs, being seen of them 40 days, and speaking of the things pertaining to the kingdom of Yahweh.
All right, so now 40 days. Why 40 days? Just draw a line, because he's got to fulfill. Israel back here, they were 40 years in the wilderness, right? A day for a year, prophetically speaking. He's also got to fulfill the tabernacle pattern, because how many weeks did it take to build this tabernacle? 40 weeks, just like that's how long it takes for your tabernacle to be built, you know? Okay? Now, we're over there in Acts. Jump down, I think it's to the eighth verse. What does it say?
But ye shall receive power after
Go a verse above that, because I think they asked the question, and he's answering it.
Six.
Six, all right.
When they therefore were come together, they asked of him, saying, Rabbi, wilt thou at this time restore again the kingdom to Israel? And he said unto them, It is not for you to know the times or the seasons which the Father has put in his power, his own power. But ye shall receive power after the Holy Spirit is come upon you.
Mm-hmm.
And ye shall be witnesses unto me, both in Jerusalem and in all Judea and in Samaria and unto the uttermost parts of the earth. And when he had spoken these things, while they beheld, he was taken up, and a cloud received him out of their sight.
Mm-hmm.
And while they looked steadfastly towards heaven as he went up, behold, two men stood by them in white apparel, which also said, Ye men of Galilee, why stand ye here gazing up into heaven? This same Yahshua, which is taken up from you into heaven, shall so come in like manner as ye have seen him go into heaven.
All right, good enough. Now, and see, and look, and everybody has a different interpretation of what this is. Play 14. Right here. Okay, thank you. All right. The reason why I have this up, so that I can accentuate these veils here. These veils represent points of transition. Anytime you cross a veil, there has to be a transition. Okay? Here, we have angelic invisibility. In other words, if it's behind this veil, you can't see anything because it's in a state of angelic invisibility. Okay? Now, let's just draw a line. That's what's happening here. When he said he stepped up into a cloud, see, in other words, he stepped behind the veil of angelic invisibility. Let's draw a line. It's the same here for the high priest on the Day of Atonement. All right? He came here, he had to put on the garments of beauty and glory, the mitre, the breastplate, the ephod, and then he went up behind the veil. See, somebody's standing out here. You can't see him because there's a veil. You can't see up in here. He goes behind the veil, all right, and does his thing, the figure eight, you know, and then comes back out. Well, of course, when he's up there, he's got to turn the ark around, and while he's turning the ark around this way and he's facing east, he has to flick the seven, you know, drops of blood that way, okay? And then he pushes the ark back around, and then he comes back out from the other side of the veil and comes back out to here, figure eight. All right, but going behind the veil, invisible. All right, now draw a line, and that's the same way here. Now get 1 Corinthians 15, I think it's 44, it's somewhere around there. See, here's the problem that the world has with Yahshua's death, burial, resurrection. See, they think that his resurrection is a physical resurrection. So because they think it's a physical resurrection, then they believe he physically went into heaven. And so when he so-called comes back, he's going to physically come back. That's the error. But we're going to show you otherwise. What we got?
1 Corinthians 15:42.
You know what? This is really a good set of passages if you really understand it. Go up to,
15:40.
Uh-huh.
There are also celestial bodies and bodies terrestrial.
Now, there are celestial bodies and bodies terrestrial. Come on out. I need to point. This is a celestial body. Talking about Elohim. This is a celestial body. And then we got the man Adam here. He is a body terrestrial, because the word terrestrial means of the earth. So there's celestial bodies and there's bodies terrestrial. The point I'm trying to show is this is a celestial body. and not a body terrestrial. But we're going to get to that. Read.
But the glory of the celestial is one, and mm-hmm. the glory of the terrestrial is another.
Read.
There is one glory of the sun, mm-hmm. and another glory of the moon, and another glory of the stars. For one star different from another star in glory.
Now you can see that at the night sky. Some stars look brighter than others. And the reason why is because they have a different magnitude. See, that's in the old days, the astronomers used to measure a brightness of a star by labeling it a certain magnitude. They would say, well, this star up here, this is the brightest star up here. So therefore, we will say this is a star of whose brightness is of the first magnitude. And then we say, well, this star is not as bright. It's bright, but not as bright as this one. So we'll say it's a star of the second magnitude, and so forth and so on. Stars are a type of angels. See, and Lucifer, who was in heaven, was considered to be the wisest and the brightest angel of all. Therefore, one could say that when he had his place in heaven, he was an angel of the first magnitude, because he was the wisest and the brightest of them all, until iniquity was found in him and he was cast out. See, through this veil. Now, when he's cast out, he's got to pass through this veil of angelic invisibility. Now he's here in the holy place. Now he's in a state of angelic visibility. That means now he could be seen in a vision. Okay? That's what happened up here when he appeared to Eve. He appeared to Eve in a state of angelic visibility. Okay? Now, just to complete this journey on this plate. Now, when he comes through the veil, this is a veil, the division between invisibility and visibility. That simply means this. Here he is out here. He is marked for the flesh. There's no flesh yet because this is the unformed earth. And so he's out here, as the scripture is saying, he's out there going to and fro, seeking on whom he may devour. And he didn't do anything. See, he didn't do anything until this event happened. See, he sat up and watched all this. And see, he saw all of this happening here. He saw all of this happening here, the spirit moving across the face of the deep. And he didn't do nothing. Even he saw the man Adam created, come from the dust of the earth, then being placed, then given a soul, and see, and that body and soul is emanating from the spirit that is in the midst of the man. And see, and Adam was placed in the midst of the garden. Even, you don't see Satan around here, but then once the woman, see, here's Adam being placed in a deep sleep, and the rib and the womb is taken out, and the womb man is brought to him, and now they're up in the garden in peace and in harmony. Now here he comes. He's been watching all along, but then once the woman is made, he comes along. Why? Because it's the same modus operandi that he did up in heaven. When he set up his kingdom up here, he went after the bride or the angelic host, which is a type of the woman or the bride. Okay? Keep reading.
42.
Uh-huh.
So also is the resurrection of the dead.
So now also is the resurrection of the dead. I'll go over here because I think I could do a little more of a comparison here. Go ahead.
It is sown in corruption. Now it is raised in incorruption.
Now his sown, talking about Adam, it's sown in corruption. The first Adam is sown in corruption, but it's raised incorruptible. Mm-hmm. All right, go ahead.
It is sown in dishonor. Huh? It is raised in glory.
It's sown in dishonor. Look at him. Does he look dishonorable at this point? Got his hands over his face. Sown in dishonor. But raised in what?
But is raised in glory.
Raised in glory. Go ahead.
It is sown in weakness. It is raised in power.
It's sown in weakness. What do you mean it's sown in weakness? When the woman was taken out of the man, she was made subject to vanity. Not willingly, but by him who also subjected her in hope. Wait a minute. Keep your finger there and read Romans 8 and 20, just to emphasize that point.
Romans 8:20.
Uh-huh.
For the For the creation was made subject to vanity.
Now the creation, which was Eve, see, or the creature, was made, the creature was made subject to vanity. Talking about Eve. When she was taken out of Adam, she was not covered in the sun. She was not clothed in the sun. So she was made subject to vanity. Read.
Not willingly.
Not willingly, because if it was up to her, she'd have been content staying within Adam. But according to the purpose, she had to be taken out and be made subject to vanity. Read.
But by reason of him who hath subjected the same in hope.
Now, after the transgression, that's when she was made subject to her husband. And when her husband was cast out, she followed him. She followed her hope. Get it? She was made subject to him and subject to her hope. It's the same way here. The woman is made subject to her hope. Who is Yahshua? That's why all these folks that were resurrected from the dead, they followed him back into Jerusalem, which in this case is type the Garden of Eden. If the man followed the woman out of the garden, then you got to see the woman following the man back into the garden. Keep reading. I'm sorry, Genesis. I mean, 1 Corinthians. I'm sorry. Thank you. Corinthians. You're back at, 15 chapter.
44. Mm-hmm. It is sown a natural body.
Now, it's sown a natural body. You're talking about the man Adam. It's sown a natural body. Read.
It is raised a spiritual body.
But it's raised a spiritual body. Talking about Yahshua the Messiah, whom they call Jesus Christ. It's raised a spiritual body, not a physical body, but a spiritual body.
Right.
Read.
There is a natural body.
There is a natural body, which is Adam, which we are all descended from. See, we've told you this before. The whole human race is one flesh. All 8 billion of us, you know, we're all from Adam. So we're all one flesh, physical. Mm-hmm. But read. But there's a spiritual body. Read.
And there is a spiritual body.
Now there's a spiritual body, which is Yahshua Messiah. Just as all men come out of Adam, all man has to go back into Adam, the spiritual Adam, who is Yahshua the Messiah.
Mm-hmm.
Go ahead.
And so it is written, mm-hmm. The first Adam was made a living soul.
Now the first man was made a living soul. Okay, go ahead.
The last Adam was made a life-giving spirit.
He was made a life-giving spirit or a quickening spirit. All right? Keep going.
Howbeit, that was not first, which is spiritual, but that which is natural.
But see, the first thing that happened was the natural. But see, but that was necessary. How are you going to see the spiritual unless you can see the natural first, pointing to the spirit? See? Go ahead.
But that which is natural, and afterwards that which is spiritual.
Uh-huh.
The first Adam is of the earth, earthy.
Mm-hmm.
The second Adam is Yahshua from heaven.
The second Adam is Yahshua from heaven. See, go ahead.
As is the earthy, such are they also that are earthy.
Mm-hmm.
And as is the heavenly, such are they also that are heavenly.
Read.
And as we have borne the image of the earthy, mm-hmm. we shall also bear the image of the heavenly.
All right. Now, read the next one.
Now this I say, brethren, that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of Yahweh, neither does corruption inherit incorruption.
Now, see, now that should tell you right there that when Yahshua resurrected from the grave, he did not resurrect a physical body, because corruption does not inherit. I mean, corruption don't inherit incorruption. It's got to be, you know. See, look, Dr. Kinley said it best. And he said it like this. He said, look, you cannot get a sinner to atone for another sinner. You'd have to get a righteous man for that. See, or a sacrifice that is not spotted. Because, see, draw a line. See, back here, there couldn't be no, you know, we say that there could be no bones, but there couldn't be no spot to this sacrifice, no defect, you know, like, you bringing in a lame, you know, as lame, limping and whatnot. No, there had to be no spots, no blemishes,
right.
Nothing like that. See, that's why when Yahshua, where we at? Oh, I'll come right here. When Yahshua went to John the Baptist, you know, this was a water baptism of repentance. And he said, now, have you any sins to remit? And Yahshua said, no. And John said, well, you need to baptize me. But he said, permit it to be so, you know. For thus it becometh us to fulfill all righteousness. The only righteousness they could have at that time if they could obey these 613 ordinances. But anyway, I want to get back to this because our subject, and I know it seems like it's a long way to get to plate 32, but see, and I've spoken this before, once you begin to understand the rhyme and the rhythm of these plates, you'll see that certain plates have affinities to each other. Like, you know, I could have just taken this plate and just talked about it by itself, all right? But I felt it was better to show Yahshua, who's fulfilling Moses' third trip into the mount, showing that how this is, what this is showing you, because Moses is bringing up his own set of stones to be written into, which is a type of the second covenant, which is what the New Testament is. Okay, now let's go back to Exodus. I think it was the 30 where Moses is up there. It was 40 days where you left off from there. I think it's 30.
Exodus 34:29.
Uh-huh.
And it came to pass when Moses came down from Mount Sinai with the two tables of stone, tables of testimony in Moses' hand,
mm-hmm.
when he came down from the mount, that Moses knew not that the skin of his face shone while mm-hmm. they talked with
mm-hmm.
him.
Mm-hmm.
And when Aaron and all the children of Israel saw Moses, behold, the skin of his face shone, and they were afraid to come nigh him.
Mm-hmm.
And Moses called unto them, and Aaron and all the rulers of the congregation returned unto him. And Moses talked with them. And afterwards all the children of Israel came nigh, and he gave them in commandment all that Yahweh had spoken with him in Mount Sinai. Until Moses had done speaking with them, he put a veil on his face.
Mm-hmm.
But when Moses went in before Yahweh to speak with him, he took the veil off until he came out. And he came out and spake unto the children of Israel that which he was commanded.
All right. So now Moses' face glowed like the sun. They couldn't look at him. It was that strong. And so he had to put a veil over his face so that they wouldn't be blinded by the light. Mm-hmm. So to speak. But then it said when he went in and spoken to Yahweh, he could take the veil off. Now, what right. is that happening? See, now the first speaker talked about the meeting tent of the congregation back here. All right. Let's read that. I think it's 33, Exodus 33 and maybe round 7.
Exodus 33 and 7. And Moses took the tabernacle and pitched it without the camp afar off
mm-hmm.
from the camp and called it the meeting tent of the congregation. And it came to pass that everyone which sought Yahweh went out unto the meeting tent of the congregation, which was without the camp. And it came to pass when Moses went out unto the meeting tent that all the people rose up and stood every man at his tent door and looked after Moses until he was gone into the tabernacle. And it came to pass as Moses entered into the meeting tent, the cloudy pillar descended and stood at the door of the meeting tent, and Yahweh talked with Moses. And all the people saw the cloudy pillar stand at the meeting tent door, and all the people rose up and worshiped every man in his tent door. And Yahweh spake unto Moses face to face mm-hmm. as a man speaking unto his friend. And he turned again into the camp, but his servant Joshua, the son of Nun, a young man, departed not out of the meeting tent.
All right. Now, he departed not out of the meeting tent. Now, mind you, we're in the 33rd chapter. We had read the 34th chapter where Moses went up with his tables of stone, but he went up by himself. On the second trip, he had Joshua, the son of Nun, go up with him. And he had Joshua, the son of Nun, and said, tarry ye here and wait for us. But this time on the third trip, Moses is up there by himself. He goes up mm-hmm. by himself. However, when he goes up, he sees Elohim up here. How did that happen? Well, we just read that Joshua, the son of Nun, he did not leave out of the meeting tent of the congregation. But how was it that Moses went up the mountain and he saw Elohim? Well, Joshua's down here from the meeting tent. He is astral projecting up into the cloud on Moses' third trip. And that's why Moses sees Elohim up here. And then he sees the recapitulation of the vision and the 63 generations afterwards. Okay? But now Moses coming down from the mount, and his face is glowing. Now here, here's Joshua. He's ascended into heaven, and look, and see, and he ascended up into a cloud. And with the way we got it illustrated here, he's in the midst of the cloud, flanked by two angels. All right, we can draw a line. Just draw a line, and we come here to the Ark of the Covenant. See, here you got the cloud that sat on the mercy seat, flanked by two archangels. Okay, so now Joshua, this is a vision. And we got it written here. This is a vision that that they saw, because we've ascertained that this was not physical. Right? Joshua rose a quickening spirit. This is not physical. And then now this is at the end of 40 days after his resurrection. Now 10 days later, he's going to pour out the Holy Spirit on those in the upper room. Let's read that. Acts the second chapter.
Acts 2 and 1.
Mm-hmm.
And when the day of Pentecost was fully come, while they were all with one accord in one place, suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind,
mm-hmm.
and it filled all the house where they were sitting. And there appeared unto them cloven tongues like as of fire.
Okay, as of fire. Cloven tongues like fire. Why doesn't fire emit light? Draw a line. It'll be like the cloud back here. Cloud by day, pillar of fire by night. Draw a line. The light of the lampstand here in the tabernacle. Okay? Keep going.
Where was I?
You have
and
three.
There mm-hmm. appeared unto them cloven tongues like mm-hmm. as of fire
mm-hmm.
and rested upon each of them.
Mm-hmm.
And they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak with other tongues mm-hmm. as the Spirit gave them utterance.
Read.
And there were dwelling at Jerusalem Jews, devout men out of every nation under heaven. Now when this was noised abroad, the multitude came together and was confounded, because that every man heard them speak in his own language.
Okay, so now I heard him speak in his own language. In other words, see the people outside, it sounded like babble. See, confusion. See, but the Holy Spirit was speaking through these people, and these people were from different parts of the Roman Empire that spoke different dialects of Hebrew and whatever, but they all understood each other. Whereas people on the outside who were not, you know, doused with the Holy Spirit, they heard it and said, what is this babble? Why is it like that? Where am I at? Plate, Tower of Babel. That's what I want. 22, yeah. Here. Because, see, you had the confusion of tongues back here. But now, see, because of the confusion, see, now prior to this, the whole world spoke one language, and that was Hebrew. Now, after this event, now you got all these multiplicity of languages. See, the confusion of tongues. But now here, Yahweh is bringing these tongues back together, reversed at Pentecost. So now they speak one language. Pulling. Okay, that true language, you know, which is the language of Yahshua the Messiah, see, okay? All right, that one language, the true Hebrew language, the language that Hebrewed, talking about Yahweh, okay? Keep reading.
And they were all amazed and marveled, saying one to another, behold, are not all these which speak Galileans? And how hear we every man in our own tongue,
uh-huh.
wherein we were born?
Skip all that, because it's yeah, just get down to 12. And they were amazed. 12.
And they were all amazed and were in doubt, saying one to another, what meaneth this?
Because they heard them speaking their languages, you know, and they understood them, all right? But the people on the outside, it sounded like this place, babble, confusion. They're like, what is going on? And so now read.
others mocking said, these men are full of new wine.
No, that's what Joe Williams used to say. Oh, they must be drunk over there. That's what's happening. They drunk, you know. Yeah, it's pretty early, man. Man, these folks, they love to party early, man. They must be drunk up in here. But read.
But Peter, standing up with the 11, mm-hmm. lifted up his voice now and said unto them.
He's standing up. See, in other words, amongst the men. That's like the intercessor. Draw a line. See, that would be like the golden altar of incense here. Or here in the migratory pattern. See, that's that angel in the cloud. See, he was the intercessor between Yahweh and man. See, go ahead. Or Joshua, son of Nun, actually. But read.
Ye men of Judea and all ye that dwell at Jerusalem, mm-hmm. be this known unto you and hearken to my words. For these are not drunken as ye suppose, mm-hmm. seeing it is but the third hour of the day.
Yeah, we ain't as drunk as you suppose. See, it's only 9 o'clock in the morning, you know, so we're not as drunk as you suppose, but read.
But this is of that which was spoken by the prophet Joel. Mm-hmm. And it shall come to pass in the last days, saith Yahweh, I will pour out of my spirit upon all flesh. Mm-hmm. And your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. And your young men shall see visions. And your old men shall dream dreams.
All right, good enough. So in the words that came out of his mouth, they were by the Holy Spirit. See, and that would be like the bread. See, come to the migratory pattern. That would be like the manna here. So our line. That would be like the table of shewbread here. See, we're looking at these principles, okay? And so, and these, you know, some, maybe we should read those people that came there, because they came here from the four corners of the earth, which is the 40 principle. And this, well, actually, let's read something else. There's something else I think I found out. Acts. Oh, we did read it, because it was the third hour of the day. So the Holy Spirit, yeah, that's what I wanted to say. Because people have asked me, what's the 40 principle on this plate? See, there was a third hour of the day, so the Holy Spirit fell on them within that hour. 1 hour, prophetically speaking, is the same as 40 years. Right. That's the principle there. Mm-hmm. That's the 40 principle on here, because it happened within that hour. Okay? Now, down here, see, this is what I say about this. Give me this whole plate. What I say about this plate, this is a descending plate, as we just went through, because, see, Yahshua's coming down, you know, rending the veil, and he's pouring the Holy Spirit out on them. It's an ascending plate, because now people get confused about these illustrations, because they say, well, Yahshua's eating the Passover, and he's washing their feet, but this is after his death, burial, resurrection. What gives? See, these things, see, they didn't understand what was happening here until the day of Pentecost, when it was brought back to their remembrance why Yahshua ate the Passover with them, why Yahshua washed their feet. Maybe we can read that, a part of it. It's in the textbook. It's volume 4. Volume 4, I think it's page 17. Yeah, we can read part of this. Volume 4, page 17, first paragraph.
Yeah. In plate 2E illustrates the
No, that's not 2E. Yeah, this one. Yeah, plate 30.
In plate 32E,
uh-huh.
at the Last Supper, the night before Yahshua was crucified, he ate the Passover with his disciples in the upper room mm-hmm. in fulfillment of the memorial of the first Passover, which was instituted in Egypt in 1491
mm-hmm.
and observed each year thereafter. The original Passover lamb in Egypt was a figure of Yahshua, the Lamb of Yahweh, who at the Last Supper took bread and brake it, and the cup, and supped, saying, this is my body, which is broken for you, and my blood of the New Testament, which is shed for you for the remission of sins. Yahshua himself, being the word of Yahweh, made flesh, rose up after he had ended the supper, mm-hmm. laid aside his garments, and took a towel and girded himself.
Can you give me a visual on that?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, I want people to see this because it's on the plate here. This is on this plate. See?
Okay.
Go ahead and read that.
After he poureth water into a basin and began to wash the disciples' feet, to wipe them with the towel wherewith he was girded, as Moses did Aaron and his sons at the brazen laver, and anointed them with the holy anointing oil.
Keep that point in mind, because we're going to revisit that. Go ahead.
Symbolizing the Holy Spirit before they could begin to minister in the sanctuary, Exodus 30:17. Judas, who was to betray him, had already departed. Then cometh Yahshua to Peter to wash his feet, and Peter saith unto him, Rabbi, doest thou wash my feet? Yahshua answered and said unto him, What I do thou knowest not now, but thou shalt know hereafter. Peter saith unto him, Thou shalt never wash my feet. Yahshua answered him, If I wash thee not, thou hast no part with me. Simon Peter saith unto him, Rabbi, not my feet only, but also my hands and my head. Yahshua saith unto him, He that is washed needeth not save to wash his feet, but to clean every whit. And ye are clean, but not all.
Okay, good enough. All right, now, the reason why these two illustrations are on the plate of Pentecost, because when they were filled with the Holy Spirit, it was brought back to their remembrance
why
Yahshua ate the Passover with them and why he washed their feet. So their understanding is ascending. Get it? See, this is descending and ascending. And they've also read, if somebody can get that in Exodus, where Moses washed Aaron's and his son's feet to consecrate them for the tabernacle. See, and the reason why, see, he's consecrating them for the tabernacle because Aaron and his two sons, they're going to officiate as priests in this tabernacle. If we can read that right quick. Do we have it? All right.
Leviticus 30, 40, 30. Yeah, you can do Exodus. It'll work.
Exodus 30, 40, and 31.
Uh-huh.
And Moses and Aaron and his son washed their hands and their feet thereat, when they went into the tent of the congregation, and when they came near unto the altar, they washed as Yahweh commanded Moses. And he reared up the court round about the tabernacle and the altar.
Mm-hmm. Good enough.
Okay.
So now they were consecrated, for the priesthood. These folks here, talking about the apostles, they were consecrated for the priesthood. Not Levitical, but after the order of Melchizedek. Not in this tabernacle, but in the greater and more perfect tabernacle, which is the universe. And what is the universe? There's a physical creation, there's an angelic creation, and then there's spirit law or eternity. Or first heaven, second heaven, third heaven. The first two heavens emanate from the third. The physical creation and the angelic creation emanate from spirit law. Your body, soul, and spirit. Your body and soul emanate from the spirit that's in the midst of you. So you're being consecrated to preach, to be a high priest, a king and a high priest. In this universe, just like they were consecrated back here, but after the order of Melchizedek. Maybe we should read that. Hebrews 6 and 19. And then I need to get something else and I'll be almost done.
Hebrews 6 and 19.
Mm-hmm.
Whither the forerunner is for us entered.
Hebrews 6:19.
Hebrews 6:19?
Yeah.
6:19.
Yeah. which hope we have as an anchor of the soul, mm-hmm. both sure and steadfast, and which entered into that within the veil.
Mm-hmm.
Whether the forerunner is for us entered, even Yahshua made a high priest forever after the order of Melchizedek.
Mm-hmm. Keep reading.
For this Melchizedek, king of Salem, priest
23.
Of...
You keep reading. Play 23. That's what I want.
For this Melchizedek, king of Salem, priest of the Most High El, who met Abraham returning from the slaughter of the kings and blessed him, to whom also Abraham gave a tenth part of all, first being by interpretation king of righteousness,
mm-hmm.
and after that also king of Salem, which is king of peace.
Well, see, now look, now we got it up here, see. Here's Abraham giving obeisance to him, and he's given the tenth portion of the spoil. Draw a line. Why? What's that pointing to? See, just like the two angels here, their wings are overshadowing this cloud sitting here. Just like, draw a line, just like you see Melchizedek overshadowing Abraham. And the Holy Spirit is blessing the seed in his loins. See, Abraham gave a tenth portion. Why? Isn't there a Ten Commandment law up here?
Right.
Tables of stone. See what I'm saying? All of this is correlatable. Because he was a king and high priest. Now, Melchizedek was a human being. All right? And the thing about Melchizedek is his genealogy was not written. You know, his birth nor his death. In fact, you can look Melchizedek up in any resource, the encyclopedia, so forth and so on. The only thing they're going to do, they're going to point you back to the Bible. The reason why we know Melchizedek exists, because Abraham said he exists. Mm-hmm. And we know Abraham existed.
Mm-hmm.
That's the reason why we know he existed. See, king and high priest, in other words, it's a type of a forever priesthood. Keep reading, 7th chapter.
Whose father and mother were not recorded in the genealogies,
mm-hmm.
as such neither the beginning of his days nor end of his life,
mm-hmm.
but being a representation of the Son of Yahweh for the continuance of the priesthood.
See, that's the same way it is today. You are in, look, because he blessed Abraham and that promise of through his seed, singular, all the families of the earth would be blessed. Well, here it is, coming on down here, promise fulfilled. First with the Jews, 7 years later with the Gentiles, coming in after the order of Melchizedek, that is to say, an everlasting priesthood. See, because this was not an everlasting priesthood, because one priest died, another priest took over. Even at the age of 50, he had to retire.
Mm-hmm.
See, and that's the same way with anything. Your preacher dies, another preacher takes over. Your guru dies, another guru takes over. Your sensei dies, another sensei takes over. Your imam dies, another imam takes over. Your dean dies, and another dean takes over. Your director dies, and another director takes over. It's all temporal. But him, this, he is eternal. This is he's the eternal priest going through the seven ages, see? And we in him. And that makes us eternal, okay? Is anything else? Keep reading. There's a whole lot you can get out of that, but I want to get something else before I conclude.
Now consider how great this man was,
mm-hmm.
unto whom even the patriarchs, Abraham, gave the tenth of mm-hmm. the spoils.
Mm-hmm.
And verily they that are of the sons of Levi, who received the office of the priesthood, have a commandment to take tithes of the people according to the law, that is, of their brethren, though they come out of the loins of Abraham.
See, in other words, see, back here, Levi was replaced by the tribe of Ephraim, and they had no inheritance up here in Canaan's land. So they had to, see, that's where the idea of tithing came from. See, each tribe had to donate a tenth part of their goods to give to the Levites, which was for the support of the tabernacle and later for the temple, because they had no land inheritance up here, even though they were given 48 cities throughout the inheritance of the 12 tribes.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? So that's what Paul, see, Paul knows what he's talking about, because he was a man of the law and the prophets and of history of his people, quickly.
But he whose descendant is not counted from them received tithes of Abraham and mm-hmm. blessed him that had the promises.
Mm-hmm.
And without all contradiction, the less is blessed by the better.
Mm-hmm.
And here mortal men receive tithes, but there he receiveth them of whom it is witnessed that he liveth forever.
See, now that's the difference. See, people in churches and all these other, they ask for tithes to use whatever they want, but they'll end up dying. They don't live forever. Joel Osteen is not going to live forever. You know, or any of these other preachers, you know, these mega churches or whatever, or the one down the, or even the one next door here, they ain't going to live forever. See, they're going to be replaced by somebody. Yahshua is the one eternal priest. Quickly read.
And if I may say so, Levi also, who received tithes, paid tithes in Abraham.
Now, even though there were people who received tithes, he had to pay tithes because he was in Abraham's loins when Melchizedek blessed him. Read.
For he was yet in the loins of his father when Melchizedek met him.
Mm-hmm.
If therefore perfection was by the Levitical priesthood, for under it the people received the law,
mm-hmm.
what further need was there that another priest should rise after the order of Melchizedek?
If this was so perfect, go read, finish that.
And not be called after the order of Aaron.
If this was so perfect, then why are we not still under it? Why was there a need for Yahshua to come in after the order of Melchizedek? And that's the problem with the world, because the Roman Catholic Church, they are after the order of Levi. They have adopted the order of Levi. That's why the Pope, technically the Pope is a king and a high priest after the order of Levi. And I know this because he can die and be replaced.
Mm-hmm.
Simple as that. One pope dies, another pope takes over.
Mm-hmm.
But not this one. It's king and high priest forever, eternally, quickly.
For the priesthood being changed, there is made of necessity a change also of the law.
Because the priesthood is changed, you got to change this law. This law of carnal ordinances is incongruent with the order of Melchizedek. Simply put, because the priesthood changed, well, we got to change this law. We got to come up with a law that's more adaptable, you know, that's more in line or in tune with the order of Melchizedek. Quickly.
For he of whom these things are spoken mm-hmm. pertaining to another tribe,
mm-hmm.
of which no man gave attendance at the altar.
Mm-hmm.
For it is evident that our Savior sprang out of Judah, of which tribe Moses spake nothing concerning priesthood.
And you're not going to read it, you know, about the priesthood out of Judah. The kingship, maybe, you know, and the scepter will not depart from Judah until Shiloh comes. That's what Jacob right. told his sons. But didn't say nothing about no priesthood, but read.
And it is yet far more evident, for that after the similitude of Melchizedek,
mm-hmm.
there ariseth another priest,
mm-hmm.
who is made not after the law of carnal ordinances, mm-hmm. Commandments, but after the power of an endless life.
Read.
For he testifieth, thou art a priest forever after the order of Melchizedek.
Okay, that's good enough. Let me get something else in here, and I'll be about finished. Because you can go on with this. I love it. Maybe we can get into another session about this. This is really, it's one of those real things that you really get into, because you see how Yahshua, who is Yahweh Elohim, is walking through the ages, you know, officiating after the order of Melchizedek. But I want to bring in something here that John on the Isle of Patmos brings up about Moses. And that is... Revelations, I think it's the 22nd chapter. I think. No, it's 21st chapter. Revelations 21 and 1. We'll read that, and I'll be about concluded.
Revelations 21 and 1. And I saw a new heaven and a new earth.
Mm-hmm.
For the first heaven and the first earth were passed away.
Now, we told you. There are three heavens. It's first heaven, second heaven, third heaven. Now, John is looking back, and he's confirming what Moses is writing. He said, and I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth were passed away, and there was no more sea. What that simply means is this. Egypt had been devastated by 10 plagues that, you know, culminating with the Passover, which was a plague itself, because it, it, 'cause if you didn't have the blood sign on the door, it would culminate in the death of the firstborn of man and beast. All right? So David, so it says, in the first, it says, I saw a new heaven and a new earth, because the first heaven and the first was no more, and there was no more sea. In other words, Egypt had been devastated. Israel had resurrected through the Red Sea. They were in the wilderness on their way to Mount Sinai, and the Red Sea was behind them. Right. That's why it said there's no more sea. Mm-hmm. Okay? Continue reading.
And I, John, saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down from Yahweh out of heaven, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband.
Now John is looking back, and we read with Moses that Moses went up the third trip. He had to come down with a veil over his face, right? He had a veil, and he had the tables of stones in his hand. And, you know, and the way the clothes were, you know, those long robes. So he had a, you know, tables of stone in his hand. He's got a veil. He's wearing a long robe. He looks like a bride. Carrying a bouquet, coming down the mountain, like a bride prepared for her husband. Mm-hmm. Talk about Moses. That's John looking back on what we read
right.
in the third trip of Moses. See, he's confirming that.
Right.
See, he's looking back and he's confirming. I said, oh, there's the, you know, a bride adorned for her husband. That's Moses with the veil on his face and the tables of stone like a bouquet of flowers. He's coming down the mountain like a bride, you know. Read.
And I heard a great voice out of heaven saying, behold, the tabernacle of Yahweh is with men, and he will dwell with them, and they shall be his people.
Yes, and then he did, because he, that cloud that led them up out of that wilderness, when they built that tabernacle, see, it was the cloud that filled the tabernacle. Maybe we could read that right quick, and I'll be about done. Exodus 40 and 34. See, the tabernacle with men. He says he's going to dwell. See, that happened back here. See?
Exodus 40 and 34?
Yes.
Then a cloud covered the tent of the congregation, and the glory of Yahweh filled the tabernacle. And Moses was not able to enter into the tent of the congregation, because the cloud abode thereon, and the glory of Yahweh filled the tabernacle. And when the cloud was taken up from over the tabernacle, the children of Israel went onward in all their journeys. But if the cloud were not taken up, then they journeyed not till the day that it was taken up. 38. For the cloud of Yahweh was upon the tabernacle by day, and a fire was on it by night. It in the sight of all the house of Israel throughout their journey.
So now they followed that cloud. When the cloud moved, they had to disassemble this tabernacle and follow that cloud. And when the cloud stopped, then they had to assemble the tabernacle, and the cloud would fill the tabernacle and plant itself between the two archangels on top of his mercy seat. So they had to follow that cloud. That's fulfilled by Yahshua. If I can just get one more scripture and I'll be done. Get Matthew, the fourth chapter. Matthew 4 and 18, quickly.
And Yahshua, walking by the Sea of Galilee, saw two brethren, Simon and Peter, and Andrew, his brother, casting a net into the sea, for they were fishers. And he said unto them, follow me, and I will make you fishers of men. And they straightway left their nets and followed him. And going on from thence, he saw two other brethren, James and the son of Zebedee, and John his brother, in a ship with Zebedee their father, mending their nets, and he called them. And they immediately left the ship and their father and followed him.
Okay, now, why did they do that? Because it would seem strange, some stranger walk up to you and just say, follow me, and you do that. Why would they do that? Because that's what happened back here. We just read about the cloud. When the cloud moved, it wasn't like, oh, the cloud's moving. Oh, the cloud is moving. And see, and they would have to disassemble the tabernacle and get everything, the curtains and the rods, you know, and they would follow the cloud. Why? Because when the cloud moved, in effect, it was telling all of Israel, follow me. That's what Yahshua's fulfilling. If Yahshua's fulfilling, then him telling the disciples, follow me, is a fulfillment of the cloud telling Israel, follow me. See, and it's the same thing that we say, you know, follow me. Talking about Yahshua, follow me. See, this tabernacle pattern. See, not me, don't follow me. But Dr. Kelly would say this, and he did say this, you know, because it's in the scriptures. And the Apostle Paul said it. He said, look, follow me as I follow Yahshua. See, all right? And see, all that we're saying is follow Yahshua, who is the archetype, original pattern of the universe, okay? And we just simply ask that you take the time to research these things. Well, actually, first relax, because there's nothing to be scared about or terrified with these charts. And we ask you to read, and we ask you to research, and we ask you to rehearse the matter. But that last R is revelation. That's Yahweh's department. However, if you do the other things proper, as Dr. Kinley was shown and was taught, and we laid it out according to the pattern, then Yahweh truly will reveal himself, because he is this vision and revelation. Okay. All right, we're out of time, and we thank you for your time and your patience. We hope that you were edified by the things that you heard, as well as enlightened, and we invite you to come and study with us again. Okay? And in closing, be safe, be healthy, but most of all, be in Yahshua the Messiah. Why? Because he most truly is your only hope of glory. And with those few words, hallelujah. Hallelujah.
All right, that concludes today's lectures. Let's all stand and be dismissed. I'll be quoting from Jude. Now unto him that is able to keep you from falling and present you falling with his presence with exceeding joy. To the only wise Elohim, our Savior, to Yahshua Messiah, sovereign, belong glory, majesty, dominion, power, both for all time, now and ever. Let us all say, hallelujah. Hallelujah.